So in this video, we are going to talk about who are account aggregators and what is their role. This is one of the news item appeared in Economic Times related to account aggregators. So account aggregators are basically, they aggregate the individual's accounts with various entities like banks, mutual fund companies, or insurance companies, or your share brokers. So account aggregator, they are responsible for transferring but not storing the client data. This is a news item. And this account aggregator concept also envisaged by Reserve Bank of India. Another news item appeared in Financial Express. So the AAR account aggregators, they are gearing up to launch its platforms. So OneMoney is the first account aggregator to launch its service from the month of April. So let us try to understand what are AAs. So before going to the actual subject, so this is a statement made by Mr. Nandan Nilkani. He is the chairman of Infosys. And he is also the father of Aadhaar, unique identification provided by the government of India to each and every resident of the country. And Mr. Nilkani is also called as India's CTO, Chief Technology Officer, because of the contribution he has made to the country. So India will become data rich. India is a developing country. So we have 1.3 billion population and a lot of data. Once people are started using a lot of smartphones and the data, digital footprints also captured whatever you do, and this data can be used for the benefit of the individuals. By this data, you can become economically rich. That is about India. Whereas in the case of Western countries like America and UK, so these countries are already economically rich. And now they are becoming data rich. So the benefit for the data rich country like India, so the benefits are more for us than the Western countries. So how we are going to capture the data for our own betterment? The India's digital initiatives, we are talking about India's stack. India's stack is nothing but the set of APIs. APIs is the application programming interface. So these are all the various computer interfacing tools, so that one computer will be talking to other computer and that computer will be talking to your mobile. So it's all happening through the internet. So this India's stack allows the governments, non-governments like business companies and also startup companies and also developers to use this platform, the digital platform, for solving India's problems. So India being a developing country, high populated country, we have a lot of problems. Starting from health and financial inclusion and also delivery of services. So how we can integrate these various interfaces through the digital technologies for solving our problems. So in the India stack, there are three major variants. One is presenceless. It's not that you have to be present yourself to avail the services. And these services, many services, they are trying to bring under paperless mode. And the services, whatever you get, and you need not pay by cash, but you can pay through digital mode. And Government of India, regulators like SEBI, Reserve Bank of India, Pension Fund Regulatory Authority. So they are trying to use this India stack or the digital platform along with various financial institutions and also the digital companies to use these services for solving the problems. It may be opening a bank account or opening of a pension account or any other services. So we are all pro bono partners. Pro bono means voluntarily we are partnering ourselves for offering these services, not only for development but evolution, for evangelization of these API and systems. So in India's tech, there are four tech layers. It starts with presenceless and paperless and also cashless and consent. For availing this digital services, unless otherwise the customer or the particular individual is giving the consent, then this mode won't work. I should give my consent. So under this broad theme, this account aggregator is going to work under the regulations of the Reserve Bank of India. This account aggregator is trying to build a data empowerment and protection architecture, DEPA. So what is it, data empowerment and protection architecture? Currently, that data, whatever is being generated in the country, it's all towards a particular organization. It may be a banking company, or it may be a mutual fund company or an insurance company. So the data is centering around the organizations. So by this DIPA, the Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture, it is trying to move from organization centric to human centric approach. Human centric means in what way this data can be used for my own benefit, for the benefit of the individuals. So this is a paradigm shift in personal data management. So moving from one center to other center. Data Empowerment and Protection Architecture, there are various bodies. FIU, solve financial institution, financial information users. FIU entity are individuals, and financial information providers. So the providers may be a bank or mutual fund companies. So this, from user to provider or provider to user, it is working based on the express consent. I provide my consent so that the data will be provided by the FIP to FIU. It may be an individual or an entity. Here I am going to describe some of the important terminologies and also the meaning of it related to the account aggregator and also the data empowerment architecture. So I request each and every listener of this video, please listen it carefully and also use this particular terminology whenever you interact with your own colleagues in the office, whenever you are writing on that particular subject. If you use this particular technology term, and there are a lot of chances for you to get admiration and also for you getting appreciation from your superiors and also from your supervisors. Account aggregator is a financial architecture. It is built on digital public goods. So what is this public good? Data is a public good, and it is digital data is being treated as a public good, on which, based on the consent, the financial architecture called account aggregator or AA is built. Digital financial goods, it allows for building so many innovations on the top of it. And the existing, the digital financial goods are our Aadhaar, EKYC, UPI, Unified Payment Interface, GST, Goods and Services Tax Network, and JAM. JAM is your Jandan accounts, Aadhaar and mobile interlinkage. So these are all the your digital financial goods, and wherein you avail the services in a paperless and a cashless and presenceless mode. The architects of the account aggregators, they mention that the evolution or the starting of account aggregators is a seminal moment for the country. Seminal means it's an idea of great importance which is going to influence within a particular discipline. So this can be scaled up. It's not only restricted to financial goods, but also non-financial goods and services can also be built around this account aggregator model. So the data, as I told you, from it's moving from organization-centric to human-centric. So data is not only for government and company, but for individuals. And the account aggregator is a concept coined by, or maybe it's proposed by Reserve Bank of India, and in consultation with other regulators through a forum, through a joint forum. It's one of the first in the world. Nowhere this account aggregator concept is available. And this account aggregator is industry agnostic, means it's not specific to particular industry. It can be applicable to finance and non-finance. It may be banks, or maybe in delivery of health, or it may be in delivering of skills. So industry like health, skills, education, wealth management, banks, all can use this account aggregator. So basically the account aggregator, it's aggregating the digital footprints of the individuals, banking transactions, or your the income tax returns, and also your GST returns, and your mobile call data. So all these things are aggregator, and it is given to the users by the providers in a format which is required so that the decision making will be easy. So this personal data used for my own personal enrichment so that my life is bettered. Account aggregator will work only based on the consent. So electronic consent artifact, there is a format through which the electronic consents are being accepted and it's being presented. This is a artifact developed by MeitY. MeitY is the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. It's a central ministry. So this consent, I can program it. I can give a consent to give this data of mine to a particular the entity, and that consent I can allow or disallow at any time. So account aggregator is first in the world to be launched by country, and already work is going on. There are many entities, they are going to provide this facility. This is idea floated by the Reserve Bank of India, and also discussed in FSDC. FSDC is Financial Stability and Development Council. It's a inter-regulatory and technology group. So wherein all the regulators like Reserve Bank of India, PFRDA, SEBI and IRDA, they are all part of it. So all these financial entities regulated by these regulators will be part of this. So API, this application program interface, this is an interfacing tools between computers and also your mobile phones, set of tools through which the data is being sought and also being presented based on the consent. So in account aggregators, they can transfer the data, encrypted data, the data will be encrypted. But don't worry, that account aggregators are regulated entities. The data will be shared in an encrypted format, but this account aggregator, they cannot access the data for their own benefit. They cannot sell the data. Here there are two kind of entities. One is a user, the other is a provider. So user can be a provider also, and provider can be a user also. So the account aggregator, they are going to act as fiduciary. So their role will be fiduciary. It's like a trust. It's, they are the guardian of the data. They cannot use the data for their own benefit. And the lenders, the financial lenders, are the banks and financial institutions, NBFCs. They can use the data of the particular individual aggregated from various sources so that they can disperse a loan on real time without taking much time to the eligible borrowers. And for example, some banks, based on the data of their customer, they can improve the product offerings, so that they can design the product according to the need of the customers. Kotak Bank, they are already on the job. They are trying to build an account aggregators. They are testing this AA concept among its staff members. And lending by the banks and NBFCs will be based on the flow of income, based on the digital income or the digital footprints which you have. So the banks or the lenders, they need not even ask for collaterals. Nowadays, the lending is based on the collaterals. Go to a bank and ask for a loan, they will ask for collaterals. So now, based on the digital aggregation model, so the lenders will be ready to give the loan based on the flow of income rather than the assets and collaterals. So the data empowerment architecture is interoperable. It is not that it is restricted to only banks. Even the non-banks, the data can flow, and it can flow from the government departments. It can flow from the income tax department. It can flow from the telecom companies. So the information is being optimized. That information is being optimized for offering better products. So basically, the account aggregator, they are going to do three things. One is the collection of the data from various sources, assemble it and also synthesize it and present in the format required. Of course, there are some challenges. People are worried that by being this account aggregator, they can access my data. Don't worry, because these are all regulated entities. So the data privacy, you may see as a challenge, but it's not a challenge at all. So the users, who are the users? All the financial entities, non-financial entities, and the 1.3 billion population of the country, and also the 1 crore GST filers in the country. There are 1 crore companies and firms, they are filing the GST data, so they can also use the data. So in 2016, not very long back, it's only 3 years back, this concept was developed by Reserve Bank of India. And this account aggregator, they are also called as consent broker. So there, it's like aggregating the data based on the consent. So this is the architecture of the account aggregators. You may see that the center is that individual or the citizen of the country. So on one side, FIP are financial information providers. On the other side, they are the FIU, financial information users. So in between the financial data access fiduciary are the account aggregators. They take the request or accept the consent, and they transfer the data in the fiduciary capacity. So the providers are the banks, mutual fund companies, or insurance companies, or tax and GST platform. Users are your flow-based credit lenders and also personal finance management providers and wealth management providers and robo-advisor. Robo-advisor is nothing but providing advice for financial management and with a minimum human intervention. It is based on the online facility, online tools. So the fiduciary role of account aggregator, it's working on two basic concepts. One is electronic consent. I give the consent. So he said electronic consent is equivalent to the digital equivalent of a physical letter. It's not that you have to write a letter to give the consent. You can provide through electronic consent, and that consent will be transferred based on the consent artifact. It's a machine readable electronic document. So two things, electronic consent and consent artifact. So electronic consent is the digital equivalent of a physical letter for the permission given by an user. Based on the permission, the data provider will be sharing the information to the user and for a particular purpose. So already the electronic consent is working in eKYC, e-signature, and digital lockers. And the data will be electronically and securely transferred with service providers on as needed basis. It's not that it will be a continuous flow, it will be only on as needed basis. So the data being transferred electronically, there will be traceability and the data trails also will be there. And consent artifact is a machine readable electronic document that specifies the parameters and scope of data. So the digital signature is part of the consent artifact. Thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe to Learn by Choice for more and more videos.